Hi, I'm Travis, and this is Curious Tangents. And there's an old saying that goes, when the facts change, I change my mind. What do you do? And what you do is probably not change your mind. What everyone does is probably not change their minds, because minds are difficult to change. But why? The mind has many biases. One of the ones that get in the way of us seeing eye to eye most often is the false consensus bias. This is our tendency to falsely believe that those around us believe the same things as us. I do this frequently with my own information. I assume that everyone watching my videos on YouTube knows all of the things that I know, and so I don't make very much content. This is one reason why other people's political beliefs can be so surprising. But enough on cognitive biases. Let's imagine that you lived in the year 1500, before the heliocentric model of the solar system was devised. In fact, it wouldn't even be called the solar system. It would just be called Earth and the universe around it. The heliocentric model is the model that dictates that the sun is the center of the solar system, and Earth and all the other planets orbit that star. Common sense today. However, in the year 1500, we had the geocentric model, stating that the Earth was the center of the universe, and that everything around it, including the sun, orbited the Earth. Now, this story worked incredibly well. If you know nothing about astronomy or astrophysics, and you wake up every single day to see the sun rising in the east, then it makes sense that the sun revolves around the Earth. Around the year 1545, a man named Copernicus would drop something called On the Revolution of Heavenly Spheres, and this would destroy our version of the universe over time. Now, Copernicus was not completely accurate in his depiction of the solar system. He put the sun at the center of the entire universe, and it's debatable today if the universe actually has a center. But he was more accurate, and more accurate is how scientific information progresses. Why am I telling you this story about Copernicus in a video about biases? Because his theory, the heliocentric model, was not fully accepted until 1822. But Copernicus was lucky in a way. He lived to see his ideas be at least moderately accepted, and he lived a long life. A man named Ignaz Semmelweis would not be so lucky. If you've ever taken a medical class, you probably have heard this name before. He came up with a rather controversial idea, an idea that says you should wash your hands before delivering a baby. In April of 1847, the maternal death rate was a whopping 18%. But thankfully, hand washing was instituted in May of that same year, and by July, death rates were just over 1%. Semmelweis was ridiculed for his idea in the larger medical world that cleanliness mattered. Some doctors, feeling offended by the idea that they may be responsible for the deaths of these women, even went out of their way to operate with unclean hands. A disturbing thing, I know. He was ridiculed so much that he was essentially exiled from Vienna and from his medical practices. Semmelweis would then be admitted into a mental health hospital, and 14 days later, he would die, presumably from wounds sustained by being beaten from the guards. Now, some of you may find that story disturbing, but wait until you hear what I've got to say next. I'm kidding, of course. Semmelweis had an incredibly difficult time, not because he was pushing for society to wash their hands, but because he was pushing an invisible boulder uphill, a boulder that's near impossible to move. And the name of this boulder is the status quo. Status quoism, or status quo bias, may be, on a sociological scale, the most powerful thing in existence. Society's proclivity to do as society always does. The older you are, the more susceptible you probably are to this bias. We all live lives that are, in a way, dictated by societal norms and our own habits. Habits that strengthen every time you do them. People want balance. In fact, the nature of life itself, homeostasis, is a being in balance. And things that are balanced are by definition not moving. But there are things that we can do to slowly but surely change the minds of others and of ourselves. There is a saying that goes, he who knows only his own country knows no country at all. I assume this was by John Stuart Mill's, but it turns out it's not. It's actually something I just made up. However, it does a great job of analogizing our inability to see how things could be different, because we don't always have knowledge of things being another way. We often fail to realize that our understanding of a subject is incomplete. There are multiple ways to run a country or a financial system and to have different cultures. There are alternatives to our educational system, which most people, regardless of if they have recently been a student or were a student long ago, can agree probably needs some tweaking. After you've done something for a long time, you probably begin to identify with it. You don't just go to the gym, you're a gym person. I don't just make YouTube videos, I'm a YouTuber. You don't just drink alcohol, you're an alcohol. That actually may be slightly different. But you get it. Once you do something enough, it becomes, in a way, a part of you, your identity, and you will protect your identity. This plays into a thing called the backfire effect. The backfire effect is essentially an elevated version of confirmation bias. I've talked about it before. Your brain is far more invested in thinking whatever it has to get it to the point that it's at, and then it is in altering its thoughts to get it somewhere else. The human brain and the cultures that were subsequently designed by the human brain were not designed to be truth-seeking machines. The human brain is much more of a survival machine, and whatever you have thought up to now, and whatever society has done up to now, has gotten us here in 2020. Facts are generally not enough to change a person's mind on anything that they believe strongly. People listen to values and emotions. There are 6 moral matrices that make up the value structure in just about every human society that we have ever studied. But that's another YouTube video. For this, we'll only need 2 of them: loyalty and fairness. This example can be applied to a great many things in a great many different groups of people, but if you're on the political left, you will tend to value fairness more than you do loyalty, and if you're on the right, you will tend to value loyalty over fairness. Quick disclaimer, loyalty and fairness are both important to running a society, and these are just tendencies, averages over a very large group of people. If you're formulating an argument in a political setting and you know the person's political beliefs, then the thing that you should do if you need to win them over is to formulate your argument such that you are including their underlying belief. You see, the thing that works the best in debates isn't having the best information, it's having information put into the most appealing format. And thank you for watching. Like and subscribe and hit that bell if you really like it. Also, Patreon and Discord in the description. Thank you for watching.